And I'm now joined from London by Megan Green, who's the Director of European Economics at Rubini Global Economics, specialising in the Eurozone crisis. First of all, Megan, what's your reaction to that Greek deal?
I think the Greek deal is mostly a fudge, and there's severe implementation risk, particularly surrounding this debt buyback. But, you know, it is good in that it means that Greece will get the next tranche of funds, assuming everything goes according to plan, and won't default in the next couple of months, and which would probably result in a Eurozone exit. So they've essentially kicked the can a little bit, but all of their assumptions for this debt sustainability analysis that the IMF has had to conduct, they're very optimistic. And so I think this plan for Greece is predicated on an economic recovery while the economy remains in a tailspin.
Well, so, Megan, is a deal that condemns a country to almost a decade, I suppose, of misery, is that a solution in any real meaning of the term?
Well, I think this is the path that they've chosen. It's to undergo an internal devaluation to regain competitiveness and return to growth. And back when Germany had to undergo this transformation, back in the 90s when Germany was the sick man of Europe, it took about a decade for the fruits of that labor to really set in, and that was against a backdrop of global prosperity. So trying to do it now, I think, would require at least a decade of depression. The other alternative, of course, particularly for Greece, but also for the other weaker countries in the Eurozone, is to reissue their own currency, benefit from a nominal devaluation, and regain growth much more quickly. And I think eventually, particularly in Greece's case, a government is going to be put in place that's willing to consider the alternatives to the current path, which is a decade of depression.
And I suppose there are forecasts which are based over a period of 8 years. Can this deal really be meaningful at all based on forecasts over 8 years?
It's extremely difficult to forecast that far out. I mean, the IMF back in March had forecasts for Greece's debt burden. In October, the forecasts have been revised upwards by more than 20 percentage points. Now they've been squabbling over a matter of, you know, 4 percentage points out in 2020. So it's really an academic debate whether Greece reduces its debt burden to 120% of GDP by 2020 or 124% of GDP by 2020. Given that the economy is in a tailspin, Greece's debt burden simply isn't sustainable either way.
What is the message, though, Megan, to us as we keep being told the best pupil in the class? What's the message this Greek deal gives to us as a nation?
Well, I think, you know, one of Ireland's biggest challenges has been that it has hit all of its targets and has been a model student. So its negotiating position in getting concessions from the Troika has been weakened by that in some ways. That being said, Juncker said this morning that Ireland and Portugal could expect the same treatment that Greece has just received. I'm certainly skeptical that Ireland and Portugal will get all of the concessions that Greece has just been granted. But it could get they could get an interest rate reduction. It happened before previously when Ireland's interest rates were reduced off the back of Greece's. That being said, an extension of maturities or an interest rate holiday or deferral, I think that's probably unlikely.
But it's interesting at the end there of my report, we were saying, you know, how come Greece has convinced the Eurozone finance ministers that their debts are unsustainable? And we have singularly failed to do that here.
Well, there are some pretty significant differences between Greece and Ireland. One of them is that Ireland actually returned to growth at one point, though it's now back in recession. Also, Ireland's return to the bond markets. So here in London, everybody thinks that Ireland is absolutely the success story. I certainly have my doubts, given Ireland's growth model and the sort of grim prospects for fostering domestic demand in Ireland in particular over the next couple of years. Also, there's a significant difference in terms of the social situation in Ireland and Greece. So an internal devaluation is no longer really politically or socially tenable in Greece. In Ireland, the social situation is much more stable, as is the political situation. And so that brings a certain stability to Ireland that reduces kind of the urgency with which the Troika needs to address the idea that Ireland's debt burden might not be sustainable either.
But I suppose, as we're listening to Professor even Carl Whelan, one of our eminent economists here, like he was saying earlier, this could be an opportunity for us to try and get a better deal, whether it's just on the promissory note in March, that it is a moment that it's shown that deals can be done. They are doing deals, and surely we should push for a deal.
I think that's absolutely right. I think Ireland and Portugal are going to have to kind of throw their toys out of the pram over this to get a deal, but they should absolutely do so. As far as Ireland is concerned, I actually think that the government should really push for a restructuring of the promissory notes, which in my view is kind of a no-brainer. The only one Ireland would really be burning with that is the ECB, and I don't think anyone has much sympathy for the ECB anyhow. So rather than really push for the same deal that Greece has just gotten, I think Ireland should focus on maybe restructuring the promissory notes.
In terms of the euro, there's been so much discussion, Megan, over the past year or two about the future of the euro. Do you think now that it seems to be the view of the markets, you know, since the ECB's promised to buy the bonds of troubled countries, that the euro's future is now more secure?
The recent market rally that we've seen since the announcement of the ECB's bond buying program, the OMT, would indicate that. I'm more skeptical, certainly. I think that all of this euphoria surrounding the OMT will probably be reversed because all the bond buying really does nothing to address the real economies in any of these peripheral countries. What's more, the whole point of the OMT was to remove the risk of convertibility or a redenomination. And I think if Greece ends up leaving the Eurozone, which I expect it to next year, obviously the OMT won't have succeeded in removing that risk. And so that will cause investors to worry about it as well. I mean, the deal that the Eurogroup came to last night does ensure that Greece isn't going to default in the next couple of months, assuming that everything goes to plan. And that is significant. You know, some did worry that that wouldn't be the case, though the markets haven't moved much off the back of this deal, and that indicates that actually many were expecting, like me, that the money would be transferred to Greece for this time around.
Last quick question. You're sitting there in London and there's endless discussions there at the moment about whether or not the United Kingdom might actually withdraw from Europe altogether. If you were looking at us as a nation, since we're terribly self-obsessed here, what do you think that impact could have on us as a possibility?
Yeah, I mean, Ireland obviously has a special historical relationship with the UK. If the UK left the EU, that would be hugely problematic for Ireland, which has its growth model based on the fact that Ireland really serves as a springboard for multinational companies trying to gain access to the greater EU market, and that to a large degree includes the UK. So if the UK were to leave the EU, I think that would be problematic for Ireland and would certainly hurt its foreign demand.
Okay, listen, Megan, as ever, you were brilliant. Thank you very much.